Welcome to this module 4 on manufacturing systems technology. A brief recap of what we did in the last module. We talked about certain material handling systems, particularly automated material handling systems of which rhyme very well with the modern manufacturing processes. We also discussed certain robotic systems and how the field of robotics has emerged, and in fact details are reserved for later on modules. And then we started discussing about the introduction to product design process, which is a 6-step process, where we particularly discussed about what would be the aspirations when you want to design, let's say, a notebook type computer, something like that. And then in context of that, we also made a mention of computer aided design systems, which would be helping to generate more of visualization, more of clarity in the thoughts along the design refinement process of a product. Now, if you look at a brief history of how the computer aided design has emerged, in fact the CAD technology has been necessitated more because of the automotive and the aerospace industries. These are the mostly sort of, you know, the heaviest users, you would say, of so called computer aided design technology. Okay. And if you really look at how CAD had evolved, the basic footstep in the area of computer aided designing was, if you look at the, you know, the history, there is a very famous thesis by Ivan Sutherland in 1963, which talks about the basic sketchpad. Okay. So the sketchpad is now known as a interactive graphics, which was developed under the SAGE project, which is semi-automated ground environment project. And the idea was that if you have a radar map coming out of an aerospace or a airplane, can I actually pinpoint to a small zone of the map and blow it up, do all the kind of translations which could be there, so that I could actually a certain target that we would have from that radar map clearly pointed out on the screen. Okay. So it was about a pen, an interactive infrared pen, which would actually touch upon the various areas of the screens and would create impressions. Okay, within such a radar map. So this was the historically the first step towards what you know as the modern day computer aided design process. And ever since then, the variety of CAD-CAM systems have evolved. Currently there are a wide variety of such systems. And if you look at really what are the different components of such CAD systems, so obviously the three major components are the hardware, which is the tool which does the computation, the back end computation behind the visual display, the magnificent visual display that you are seeing at the front end. Okay. And it includes computer input output devices and application softwares and operating system softwares. So these are the major components of any computer aided design system. And you can see here, for example, in this sketch, that there is a database which the CAD starts with, where the CAD model is really stored, or it can be modified, or it can be uploaded. The operating system completes it comprises of application software, the graphics utility, the device drivers, which would be able to sort of communicate with a variety of input output devices. Output devices could be something like printers or plotters, where whatever you have plotted on a CAD package can be printed successfully. Input devices can be something where from which you can machine read the CAD data from a storage unit, you know, something like a let's say a hard drive or something where there is a temporary storage which can be directly mapped, etc. And obviously there has to be a user interface which would be able to define the newness in the various modalities of the CAD and try to also make new designs, etc., through this user interface. So currently the CAD-CAM systems are now classified into 4 main types. One is called the mainframe based system, the mini computer based, the workstation based, and also finally the microcomputer based system. So the main important aspect here that a person from technology background should know is that behind all this so called visualization, there is a huge amount of geometrical transformation based calculations which are being computed by the computer every second. Okay. And you need to know about such transformations and how geometrically you can manipulate an object so that you can magnify it, rotate it, translate it, so on and so forth. So let's look at some of those geometrical transformations. And obviously the need for translation or transformation is to sort of calculate when you perform a certain function on the object in question, such as rotation, translation, scaling, so on and so forth. And let us look at independently now some of the things related to, let us say, two-dimensional transformation. When we are talking about let us say a point in space which has, which is in the x, y coordinate system, okay. So you have one x value and one y value, and we typically call this plane with a x and y axis as a two-dimensional plane, and there is a point which is there on the two-dimensional plane which we want to translate, and we want to see if there exists some kind of a universal way by which we can do this translation, which is easy for a computer system to understand. So at the outset, I would like to tell you that you know, all the data management inside a computer system is becomes easier automatically when you can identify the location of the data in a big tabular kind of manner. So you can give the row number and the column number for that particular data, and it is very easy for a computer to identify and read that data once the row number and column number is specified, and also it is specified that how to approach that row number and column number. And the best way to handle such a system is by giving matrices, okay, where you would actually have all the data packaged in forms of matrices, etc. And therefore, we would like to emerge a system where such row number, column number based classification is universal across all the different geometrical transformation processes that we would like to look at. So let us say in this two-dimensional translation, there is a point which is you know, mathematically defined as Vxy, okay. So this is that point where you have a x and y coordinate, and you want to move this to a new point V dash x dash y dash, and further you know that in a two-dimensional coordinate plane like this, x and y, from the point V, which comprises let us say x and y, you are moving exactly a certain distance in the x direction and a certain distance in the y direction, let us say dx distance and dy distance, so that finally you arrive at this point x dash y dash. Obviously, x dash is equal to x plus dx and y dash is equal to y plus dy, okay. So the way to write this whole you know, transformation, and now you are linearly transforming this point from V to V dash, you are taking this point literally from V to V dash, where x dash, y dash are the new coordinates and x, y were the old coordinates. So you can actually write it in matrix form as V dash, which is a matrix x dash, y dash, okay, equal to a matrix V, which is x, y, and plus a matrix D, which is the distance matrix, which is dx plus dy. Obviously, what it would mean is that V dash equal to V plus D means that it is equal to x, y plus a matrix dx, dy, which would be x plus dx and y plus dy, which is actually nothing but x dash and y dash, as has been seen here, okay. So that is how you actually geometrically transform a certain point from one place to another on a two-dimensional plane. So can we do the same thing for a three-dimensional figure is the major question. Say, for example, two-dimensional figure, for example, let us say instead of one point, we have now a triangle which are defined by three points and interconnected through three different lines, and we want to move the triangle as is from point ABC to the point A dash, B dash, C dash, and we want to see whether the linear transformation that had been applied earlier holds true in this particular case, okay. So let us say in this particular figure here, you have coordinates of points A, B and C defined as 1, 3, okay. So that is the coordinate of A, point 4, 5, that is the coordinate of B, and point 5, 3.5, that is the coordinate of C. And now you are basically translating this triangle to the position A dash, B dash, C dash by a distance matrix, which is actually 7 minus 2 transpose. Obviously, it means that you can write it as a transpose matrix 7 minus 2 like this. So the point A dash, as per the equation V plus D equal to V dash, becomes equal to 8 and 1. Obviously, the V for the point A becomes the location coordinate 1, 3, and the distance transpose matrix becomes 7 minus 2. So this becomes 8 and 1, okay, which I have written here. And in a similar capacity, we can write the B dash as 11, 3, okay, and the C dash as 12 and 1.5, okay. So we can actually look at all these coordinates and see, for example, on the length side of BC or AC, and if this transformation were true, if we assume that this transformation is true, then the lengths AC should be equal to A dash C dash, BC should be equal to B dash C dash, and C AB should be equal to A dash B dash. In other words, even though there is a linear transformation, the triangle will not change in shape or size. All the sides are going to be in the similar length domain. So let us look at that aspect here. For example, if I wanted to calculate the length AB here, this would actually result in 4 minus 1 square plus 5 minus 3 square, which is actually equal to 9 plus 4 root, which is root of 13. If I look at A dash B dash and take the new coordinates 8, 1 and 11, 3, we also have the same root of 11 minus 8 square plus 3 minus 1 square, which is root of 13 again. So therefore, the lengths are really not changing, and therefore there is no change in scale, and the triangle is being linearly moved from place 1 to place 2 just by following this simple V dash equal to V plus D transformation matrix. You can look at all the different other lengths. For example, BC comes out to be 3.25, B dash C dash comes out to be 3.25, CA and C dash E dash comes out to be 16.25 and 16.25, which means that the transformation is working uniformly for a homogeneous transformation of a point on a two-dimensional plane. Let us talk about scaling a little bit. So if we wanted to scale an object or scale a particular structure to 2 times or 3 times the size, what is the modality which is involved in that? So let us say again we compare a two-dimensional plane where there is a certain orbit structure where you want to magnify that structure into a 3 times or 4 times larger object, again on the same two-dimensional plane. So it can be accomplished by simple multiplications, okay, and the transformation matrix that can be used is that if there is a point xy on let us say a point V in certain two-dimensional plane and you want to magnify it and transfer to another point x dash y dash. Point means that, you know, you cannot really magnify a point, but you can magnify an array of points. An array of points can be something like, let us say, this pentagon here, which talks about a length AB, for example, in the lower base, okay. And if you magnify this by 5 times, the idea is that this length A dash B dash, which is a spacing between these 2 points, should be exactly 5 times the value of the AB that we are considering here. So here, for example, X dash and Y dash, the new coordinate systems can be envisioned as Sx, X and Sy, Y, okay, where Sx and Sy represents the scaling coefficients in the X and Y directions respectively. And scaling can be expressed in the form of X dash is equal to SXX and Y dash equal to SYY. So obviously, if I wanted to represent this in terms of a simpler matrix, I would write V dash to be equal to some matrix S times of V, where this S can be represented as SX0. Now this is no longer a 1 cross 2 matrix, it is actually a 2 cross 2 matrix which emerges, which we talk about SX 0 and S 0 SY and X and Y. Let us look at if we do the product between these 2 matrices, whether we are able to get the X dash and Y dash. We already know that X dash and Y dash is actually represented here as SX, X and SY, Y at this particular zone here. So if I just product, or if I just do the multiplication between these 2 matrices, the there would be an emergence of this X dash and Y dash. The first term would be Sx X plus 0 times Y, and obviously the second term would be 0 X plus Sy times of Y. So if we finally calculate it, it is Sx times of X and Sy times of Y that we are considering to be X dash and Y dash as is represented here. Okay, so therefore, we can see that the whole point V dash is mapped to be SXX and SYY as predicted here in the earlier transformation through this matrix method. Now, we just look at this example here that there is a length AB which needs to be magnified to A dash B dash, and whether the same you know theory can be applied to these two points so that the scaling of the line can be exactly 3 times. Okay. So supposing we wanted, we have coordinates of point A here as A1, B1 and the coordinates of point B as A2, B2 and we wanted to map this to 3 times scaling, okay, as seen here. So obviously from the expression which is given here, magnification factor time X would be the new coordinate. So we have 3A1 and 3P1 as the new coordinates of A dash, and similarly 3A2 and 3B2 as the new coordinate of B dash. So you can see here that the length AB is exactly equal to 1/3 of the length A dash B dash. You know, if I just calculate the length A dash B dash here, which is 3 times of A1 minus 3 times of B1 whole square plus A2 whole square plus 3 times of B1 minus 3 times of B2 whole square, whole under the root, this becomes exactly 3 times of A1 minus A2 square plus B1 minus B2 square, and the length AB was earlier represented as A1 minus A2 square plus B1 minus B2 square whole under the root. Therefore, this exactly AB length is 1/3 of the A dash B dash length which is given in this calculation here. So this is how you can see that, you know, even if you are magnifying an object by 3 times and you put the geometrical transformation simple SXX and SXY as the magnification factor times the coordinate, the overall length is getting changed by almost 3 times because of that magnification. So in the next module, we would also like to study rotation of an object and then finally translation, and then we would like to do a very complex geometrical transformation on the 3-dimensional plane of an object.